Thank you for the invitation. It's a real honor to be here with you in Rome and to represent Poland, which has attracted public attention in Europe for many reasons. And one of them is the Constitutional Court's decision on the primacy of national constitutions over the international law, including the EU law. Nowadays, there is a series of events named Conference on the Future of Europe. The conference, according to the authors, according to the proponents of this idea, is meant to develop the institutional framework for future European integration. Unfortunately, when we look at this process, we see very strong one-sidedness and the rhetorics of false antinomies. The rhetorics of false antinomies in which just one answer is right, in which just one side of the dispute has the right to be correct. On one hand, we have this idea of ever closer union. The idea which is already in the treaties, the idea that for many reasons is very controversial, since it treats the European integration as a process. The union should be ever closer, so this process has no final goal, no final aim. It should be process going just one way and never the other, without stopping at any time. There's no field for assessment whether integration in this or that field actually works. There's no field for analysis proving that in certain respects the EU works very well, while in the other it just fails, and it's definitely much better to leave competences to the nation states. Everyone who disagrees with this idea of ever closer union is labeled as either Eurosceptical, anti-EU, a person rejecting European values, European heritage, or Europe as such. So just two possible points. Either you can be on the side of never-ending integration, or you are against any kind of international cooperation, and one can that advocates going back to the times of wars and antagonism. Of course, such antinomies are wrong. And we are here to discuss the problems of present-day Europe in their actual complexity, to go through point by point, analyzing what works and what doesn't work. The subject of particular importance is the issue of the primacy of the EU law. And also here we can see just two extreme points that are being depicted by the advocates of this absolute primacy. On one hand, there will be the idea that the EU legislation, no matter what kind of legal act it is, should override even national constitutions. On the other hand, there is this rhetorical concept that everyone that rejects this extreme notion of primacy, that extreme supremacy, rejects at all EU competences in any possible field. So EU's right to legislate. And of course, this antinomy is definitely false and true. As we all in this room probably know, the EU is based on the principle of conferral. So it can legislate, but just within the field of competences that have been conferred to the central EU institutions by the member states, and as long as the member states authorize this legislation. So in this field, there is no doubt primacy of EU provisions which have been rightly adopted over the national legislation, but just within this limited framework, within this limited scope of competences that are in the treaties. So no extreme points. There is the actual true content of the treaties that goes far beyond the ideological interpretations. Nevertheless, for many years we have seen that the EU institutions have been growing when it comes to the ipso facto, the actual practical scope of their activities and the competences. What do I mean? That on one hand, we have this content that's actually in the treaties when one reads through Treaty on the European Union or the Treaty on the Functioning of the European Union. And on the other hand, we'll see the practice which is much different. It's extremely difficult to change the international law in the federalist manner with a full consent of the societies. We have already seen it in 2002, 2003, and later years during the discussion on the possible constitution on the European constitution. We know that the radically federalist proposal was rejected in referendums in two major EU countries, that is France and the Netherlands. And it would be probably always the case if such proposals were subject to democratic vote. Therefore, there has been developed a way to circumvent democratic procedures by actions and by the case law. It's not an idea that is typical just for the European Union. This idea of judicial legislation, of social engineering through the judiciary, has been developed quite a long time ago in the United States, and it was well elaborated by Oliver Wendell Holmes, who developed the notion of so-called living constitution. He claimed that common people, that general public is just unaware, is just immature, and does not understand its best interest. More educated people who sit on the court, that are elite, can identify actual needs of common person better than the society. Therefore, there's a need of judicial legislation without any kind of popular consent, and the constitution, so just like the treaties of the European Union nowadays, is like a living body that changes throughout a time without need to introduce any kind of amendments. It can be interpreted in a different, more mature ways by the judges as the years pass by. Then this exactly the same idea was developed in the European Court of Human Rights. And we saw it first in 1978, but later it was formally named the idea of the European Convention of Human Rights as a living instrument. As a living instrument, that doesn't need to be formally changed, that doesn't need any kind of amendment in order to be interpreted differently. And now, after years, we see that basic institutions of family law, even basic institutions of criminal law of the European states have been changed, have been modified, without the consent of the people, without the debate with different sides taking part, with just decisions of judges, of the justices sitting in the Strasbourg court. And it's exactly the same thing with the primacy of the EU law. As we all know, there is no mention of the primacy in any of the treaties, especially in the binding part of those treaties. This idea was developed purely by the judges in the case law of the Luxembourg court, first in 1964 in the famous Flaminio Costa decision, and then repeated many times without reference to the substantial law provision. Of course, this has this idea of primacy, as I have already said, has its some sort of a root in the principle of conferral. So it's quite obvious that when the competences are conferred to the European Union, then the EU legislation should not be questioned. Unless, of course, this kind of legislation falls clearly beyond the authorization. From the very, very beginning, the constitutional courts of the member states have been skeptical about this general notion of primacy, starting with a series of Zollange decisions in the 1980s given by the German Constitutional Court, claiming that the primacy of the EU law can work just as long as the standard of the protection of human and civil rights guaranteed by the European legislation is higher than the one guaranteed by the German constitutions. Once the standard of human rights protection is lower than in German law, there is no primacy anymore. And it's been a consistent line of German decisions like that. If we look at at the case law of other countries in the European Union, we'll see similar decisions given by either constitutional courts of the courts of last instance in countries such as France, Czechia, Romania, Spain, Italy, and last but not least, Poland. That means clearly that there is kind of general consensus among the constitutional courts in Europe that the principle of primacy cannot be treated as an absolute one, as the principle that means that the EU law always prevails over the constitution, but just that EU institutions can act within the competences and the EC and the ECJ, Tribunal of Justice of the European Union, can interpret the provisions of EU law and national law in light of the standards that are in the treaties, but the constitutional courts remain the competent bodies when it comes to the control of constitutionality of national legislation. Otherwise, any other interpretation would mean very simple thing, that there is no union, international framework of cooperation that is composed of a number of member states, but there's just EU superstate. Since the authority to establish competences and authority to have the last word when it comes to legal interpretation is the core of the authority to legislate. And the authority to legislate, according to all the theories of the state, is just the basic attribute of the statehood. So actually, once any country agrees with the idea of this absolute primacy, it's not more a sovereign country. And it's not, I don't think it's a very controversial statement. I think it's just a statement of facts that's just undeniable. In Poland, in my homeland, it's nothing new to question this absolute and radical idea of primacy of EU law over the constitution. First, it appeared in decision of our constitutional court coming from 2005. Back then, it was a court composed mostly of people, of judges elected by center-left coalition. So, of course, being an independent judicial body, it was legitimized in this more political sense by political majorities that had nothing to do with conservatism or sovereignism, I would say. The statement of the court was very clear. Article 8 of Polish constitution says that it is the supreme law of the republic. Therefore, it's hard to question the final competence of the constitutional court to interpret its provisions, and it's hard to claim that any international legislation, even if authorized by our country, may prevail over the constitution as such. At this point, back in 2005, the court gave three solutions, since it found one of the provisions of the Treaty on of the European Union incompatible with Polish basic law. This was the provision on the European arrest warrant, while the Polish constitution explicitly expresses verbis banned extradition of a citizen to a foreign country. So there was just three clear solutions. So solution number one, the EU law can be amended, so the treaty can be amended. Solution number two, Polish constitution can be amended, and it finally happened. And solution number three, Poland can withdraw from the European Union. It was the first situation in which this issue was handled by Constitutional Court. Then it happened once more in 2011, when the court found the Lisbon Treaty generally compliant with provisions of our basic law. Nevertheless, it referred to previous decision issued 6 years ago and repeated something that is obvious, that Constitution is the supreme law of the republic. Therefore, the decision of October the 7th, 2021, which was issued just over a month ago, should not raise any kind of controversy, neither in this diachronic perspective, I mean historical perspective. There was established case law in this subject, and there was nothing new, no new quality brought by the court, neither in this synchronic perspective, this comparative perspective, since this was not exceptional when it comes to the case law in other countries. So what happened? To be honest, I can say that Poland just faced a strong political criticism and a campaign of misinformation. And a campaign of misinformation which not only referred to the character of the substantial part of this decision, so to the issue of primacy, but there was a lot of misleading information about the secondary aspects what court has said. In a number of international media outlets, we could read that the court found the provisions of the Treaty on the Functioning of the European Union incompatible with our constitution. So one could even say that the court rejected Poland's membership in the EU. In reality, the court didn't even deal with any of the provisions directly. It just rejected a number of very ridiculous interpretations of the treaties, and among those were the interpretations downgrading the role of constitutional tribunal, but also such ridiculous statements as political statements, to say it bluntly and honestly, claiming that Polish courts, referring to the while referring to the EU law, may generally ignore constitution and national legislation, or the courts referring to basing on the general EU legislation and the case law of Tribunal of Justice of the European Union may ignore decisions of other courts that have been formed of judges inappropriately elected. Of course, all those interpretations, if treated seriously, would create just a very broad judicial chaos in our country. Not a political issue, I would say. A common person could not rely on the decisions, which could be very easily questioned. So I don't think that any such interpretation could be accepted by a constitutional court in a single EU country. The problem, of course, is the politicization of the debate, the amount of fake news that are being spread, and lack of ability or willingness of many public actors to reject false narratives. Now we are in a state in which this process of indirect federalization, of the federalization that is not authorized by common people, but that is conducted behind the scenes, out of the spotlight, out of the interest of the media, and also very often out of the interest of the politicians, is just moving forward. Sometimes it's based on the judicial actions, sometimes it's based on the political or legislative actions that just go beyond the scope of competences. Very often it's based on the emotions of people, since if we spread false narratives about Polish Constitutional Court, about the situation in Poland or in Hungary or in many other countries, then emotions can be raised based on false interpretations, misleading interpretations, and those emotions may trigger certain process. What can we do in order to stop it, in order to reinstate the European Union as it was formed and as it is constructed in the treaties? First of all, we should be generally aware of what is actually happening. So it's very important to listen to the think tanks like Machiavelli Center, like MCC, like my own one maybe, and many others, since this work of those very few think tanks that are that have critical and reflective approach is vital and substantial for the debate. It's very important to publicize those critical voices that are sometimes marginalized, that are the people who raise voice like that are very often scapegoated, but still it's extremely important to report and to organize discussions like that, since just discussions like like that may possibly stop this process. And I'm sure that every one of us can raise voice in both think tank field, in academia and politics, just referring to the truth, to the accurate facts, and rejecting all those false antinomies that I began with, since rejection of the absolute primacy, rejection of the ever-closer union, does not mean rejection of Europe, does not mean rejection of the European integration as such. It also does not mean that people of Europe do not benefit from the EU at all. It would be very false and radical notion. We should not fight radicalism with another radicalism and simplicism. We should rather go back to the proper understanding of things in their true complexity, since the world is just complex. And in order to move forward with the European project, we just need to have it in mind. Thank you.